Welcome to the Underground, the Steel City Underground, a Pittsburgh Steelers podcast made by fans like you, for fans like you. Now, here's your host, Joe Kuzma.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of the Steel City Underground Podcast. I'm your host, Joe Kuzma, and I'm not flying solo today. I have not only one co-host with me today, but I also have another very special guest. Let's introduce one of those gentlemen first, Ron Lippock of the Pittsburgh Sports Daily Bulletin. Ron, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, and I'm excited because we got a name that most Pittsburgh sports fans know quite well, a guy who does very little with his spare time. Welcome, Rob Rossi. Tell us what you're doing with yourself today, Rob.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me. I am the sports editor at Upgruv and 535 Media, which is sort of the digital wing of the Tribune Review publishing company. And I also do TV for WPXI and starting my own podcast. I should mention that on I think we're taping it Monday. It's going to be more like a non-serious sports podcast. So you can I'll be tweeting that out. And you can follow me on Twitter at @RobRossi_Upgroove. So that's all the shameless plugs I have that I can think of at the moment.
No, that's
so
quite...
I should ask you what you're not doing.
Well, that's quite all right. And just so everyone knows, Upgruv is UPGRUV, and not GROV.
Yeah, we wanted to make it as easy. Yeah, we wanted to make it as easy and confusing as possible. So.
Well, Twitter.
Well, we'll tweet that out to people too. So yeah,
we took sort of the Colin Kaepernick approach. We tried to have our cake and burn it too.
Well, at least you'll be standing up, and you know, when you're doing your podcast. So that's good.
Yeah, not during the Canadian anthem, but certainly during the American anthem.
Fair enough. So we should probably jump into this stuff. And, yeah, we're going to talk Pittsburgh Steelers today, though I know you cover a lot of various Pittsburgh sports teams. But I think to start with, you know, maybe a good place to start is where it all starts with Pittsburgh, and that's with Ben. You know, give us a sense of where you think Ben is in his career. You know, we've got a couple years left with Ben, probably 2-3 years. Is he elite now, do you think? Is he a guy that we need to start looking at with replacement ideas in mind? Or are we, you know, he didn't have a great, you know, best season last season. Is that something we need to be thinking about now, or do you think he's still in his prime and ready to take us to the Super Bowl?
Wow, that could be the whole podcast right there. Look, I think Ben is an elite quarterback, but I also think that Ben Roethlisberger has to – get back to the level of consistency in his game that maybe has eluded him the past few years, which is weird because he's had such great statistical seasons when he's been healthy, you know, but he hasn't been great on the road, I think, now for going on 2-3 years. And that's sort of been offset by these otherworldly performances at home. Look, I think the Steelers have built the type of team around Ben that potentially is similar to early in his career in that he doesn't have to be everything and anything to them for them to win a championship. That doesn't mean he has to, that doesn't mean they can win a championship with him just being okay. But if he's good, they can win. Now that's A, provided they're healthy, and B, provided they keep taking strides defensively. And I think what you saw this year with the Steelers, and it's easy to overlook all of this because of the way the New England game went, but if you saw this year for the Steelers, for me, what it is as a whole, they worked in younger guys at key defensive areas, and they improved defensively. They had defensive linemen develop that if they're healthier, if they get guys like Cameron Hayward back next year, you would think they have defensive line depth, which is something we questioned here in Pittsburgh a lot going into last season and the season before. They have a potentially dominant offensive line, and they have some very encouraging young receivers that can slide it around Antonio Brown. And in Ladarius Green, if they choose to keep him and he's healthy, threat, you know, down the middle, seam routes, things like that, that can really be troublesome for teams because they have this running back in Le'Veon Bell, who is a pass catching threat in addition to being such a dynamic runner. And I think you saw them take strides this year. But because, again, they lost to some teams they had no business losing to, Philadelphia comes to mind. Quite frankly, Baltimore comes to mind. I mean, they shouldn't have lost that game in Baltimore. They were a better team than Baltimore, despite the matchup difficulties that the Ravens provide them. Because of that, they ended up having to play an extra playoff game. And look, we can talk all we want about wild card teams, including the Steelers in 2005, having success in the postseason. But the difference between winning two games to play for a championship and winning three is what the Steelers tried to do this year. Won two playoff games, but right. It's hard to win three. It's really hard to win three and then get to the Super Bowl and win it. So I think Ben, to finish your question, yeah, I think Ben is still, look, how many teams wouldn't trade their quarterback for Ben Roethlisberger? But I think Ben has tried to let the Steelers know, you've got to do the type of things to keep this team around me improving, because he's interested right now in winning. I think more than anything, he wants a chance at that third ring, because he knows that separates him. There's but a handful of guys that have three of them, right? And so I think when you hear his comments about retiring, all of that is to put as much public pressure as he can on the Steelers to get the things they need done early in the offseason so that they can go about improving the team as they did last year through the draft and whatnot.
Yeah, Rob, we talked about this. I keep telling everyone that listens in, probably the last 2-3 weeks I've been beating the whole quarterback situation to death. And I couldn't agree with you more about Ben being elite or other. We talk about just the lack of quality quarterbacks in the NFL, starting quarterbacks as it is, as opposed to backup quarterbacks. Everyone is almost looking to put Big Ben in the grave. They're already looking for his successor. And I'll tell you, I got a text here, and I told this person that texted us on the hotline. They said, should the Steelers be interested in, like, A.J. McCarron? He's saying that should they have interest in somebody like a Tyrod Taylor? And then there's the people who just flat-out hate Landry Jones. I mean, I don't know why there's such an emphasis even on the backup quarterback situation. We saw, like you said, if you put a quality team around the quarterback, Peyton Manning statistically was the worst quarterback to ever start in the Super Bowl, just a year removed. So Ben just has to be, to quote something that me and Ron said the other day, good, but not great necessarily. And they've got these pieces around them. This may be one of the, this could be the best team that Ben's had around him in a very long time, as you said, with the receivers or anything. How do you feel, though, about, are you concerned about a backup quarterback? I mean, to me, I don't think it's as big a deal as some people are panicking and making it out to be. I think Ben still has a lot of shelf life left.
Well, I think there's a difference between a backup quarterback and a replacement for Ben Roethlisberger. And Landry Jones, to me, is fine as the first one. If you're looking at him as a replacement to Ben Roethlisberger, I guess it has to be, you know, you think Ben Roethlisberger is going to be retiring after next season or something. I happen to think Ben's going to play at least 3 more years. Because, look, I can give you about 60 to 70 million reasons why.
And they're all,
you know,
green.
he made all the money. Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that. But Ben Roethlisberger made all the money on his last contract. He's one of the few players to ever do that in the NFL, sign one of those monster deals and see the whole thing through. I think he signed this last deal with every intention of doing it. You know, I also think there's a chance here, and I don't know if this is play. I sometimes I think Ben talks, and we in Pittsburgh and nationally tend to try to read into a lot of words. And Ben, to me, is one of those guys that there are times he really thinks about what he's saying, but those are usually moments when he's directing thoughts about a teammate or maybe a call or a game plan. When he does what he did after the season and just sort of like off the cuff goes, you know, I don't know if I'm playing next year. Sometimes I think he's just caught up in the moment of that interview.
And that's not the first time he said that, too. He said that the past couple of years, too.
Yeah, and by the way, he's 35 and taking a lot of abuse in terms of, you know, physical pounding. So, you know, I do think the Steelers might be wise to start looking at this as a year-to-year thing with Ben Roethlisberger. By the way, don't the Cleveland Cavaliers kind of do that with LeBron James? Not that they think he's going to retire, but kind of, you know, we got to try to win it every year because at any point, you know, we might not have him. And, you know, I think that's the difference here. I think at some point the Steelers aren't going to have Ben Roethlisberger, and then everybody in Pittsburgh is going to go, oh, geez, it sucks when you don't have that quarterback. Because like you said, look, guys, I covered the National Hockey League for 10 years before I got back into being around the Steelers about 3 years ago. And the first thing that struck me about the NFL is this. There aren't 10 guys that play that position really well. And if you don't have one of those 10, let alone one of the five that are Ben Roethlisberger, who on their best day are capable of destroying every game plan a defensive coordinator can put together, if you don't have one of those 10, you're in trouble. And the evidence I'll say is, look, in the AFC, for going on almost 15 years now, the quarterbacks in the Super Bowl have been Tom Brady, Peyton Manning, or Ben Roethlisberger, and Joe Flacco made it in once. And he
probably had to
put together the greatest postseason ever. Yeah. Yeah, but look what Joe Flacco had to do that. He had to put together like one of the greatest postseason performances we've ever seen.
Right, it was
so
like little bottom.
Past that glass ceiling, yeah. Steelers fans are in for a rude awakening. The Green Bay thing, the San Francisco thing from the 90s, Montana the Young, the Favre to Rodgers, that doesn't happen. And there's a reason only Bradshaw and Roethlisberger have taken Steelers teams to Super Bowls and won. And that's because they were really great quarterbacks. So if you can find a guy to groom to be that guy, I'm all for it. But I don't think you need to have that guy come in and be the backup quarterback this year or next.
Right. And that leads me to a question I wanted to sort of bring up here. Knowing that you've got that 2 or 3 year window left, do you get a sense that the Steelers organization is a little bit more all in terms of how it handles building this team, taking advantage of those last 2 or 3 years, knowing the window's closing?
No, because I think the Steelers do a pretty good job of, you know, building a team that can win, you know, that has a chance to win often. I mean, if you look at their history over the last, 50 years, they've been in more title games than anybody in terms of conference title games. They've been in as many Super Bowls as anybody except, I think, New England. They've won more Super Bowls than anybody. I mean, they get what it takes to build a team. I think what you saw towards the middle of Mike Tomlin's run was them get away a little bit from cutting guys a year early as opposed to getting rid of guys, too late. I think when they made that run at Green Bay and when they made that run when the year Roethlisberger began with a suspension and they got back to the Super Bowl, and they really felt like they were the better team that year. They felt like they gave that Super Bowl away. And you know what? They kept a lot of those defensive guys around. And to be honest, the next year they went 12-4. You know, they lost to a really bad Denver team in terms of compared to where the Steelers, you know, that Denver team was certainly not this New England team, obviously, right? Tim Tebow and whatnot. So, you know, it's hard to argue that keeping that Steelers team together to make another run or two at it was a bad idea because that team was still performing at a pretty high level. It all kind of fell apart on them, and that's the chance you take. I think this time what you're going to see is the Steelers maybe make some harder decisions. And by the way, maybe one of those harder decisions will be Le'Veon Bell. I argued going into this season that if their approach with Le'Veon Bell is run him until the wheels come off and franchise him a couple times, I have no problem with that because, A, so what? Running backs, if you get 6 great years out of them, you're probably not getting 7. And if he's unhappy, well, look, if you franchise him a couple years in a row, he's going to make – what, $23 million over those 2 years? That's a nice chunk of change. And if he's unhappy about it, you sit him down and go, look, we'd love to do a long-term deal with you. But the truth is, the next time you get a suspension, you're out for the season. And we can't chance that. So this is why we're doing it the way we're doing it, Le'Veon. So, I mean, if he doesn't like it, what's he going to do? He's got to play to pay, get paid. So
right.
I think maybe you'll see them do that. And I think they may have looked at this as if you're going to do Bell or Brown to a long-term deal, there's a chance you can count on Antonio Brown even despite him being a little bit older, want more than you can count on Le'Veon Bell because of A, the injuries, and B, the suspension history.
Yeah, I try to never blame the injuries necessarily on the, especially in Le'Veon Bell's situation, or even Sammy Coates for that matter. Like, when you look at a player, like going back to like Lamar Woodley, where there were always the talk of him showing up to camp, showing up to OTAs, overweight, out of shape. Then the guy does like a soft muscle tear, like a hamstring or whatever problems that he had. I think those are the type of preventable injury things you have. When you have like players just going low and taking out your knees, like with Bell, that one's a little tougher pill for me to swallow in that regard when people always say injuries. But all the other trouble he's had off the field where he missed the drug test and you know, the whole infamous scene with him and LeGarrette Blount, and that stuff is preventable to keep him on the field so he's not suspended. That's where you have some cause for concern. And correct me if I'm wrong here, Rob, though. If they signed him to a longer-term deal, which is the rumor now, I can't remember which one of the guys, Ian Rappaport or somebody, maybe Aditi Kikawala, somebody was saying it just the other day. If they sign a long-term deal for Le'Veon Bell and he does get suspended, let's say he's out of the league for a year and has to be reinstated, the Steelers do get to recoup some of that money on the salary cap. Is that correct?
Yeah, but what also happens then is you've missed a year. And it's really tough for a guy to come back after not playing football for a year as he gets older and be that guy again. And so when you sign a guy to a long-term deal in the NFL, right, it's part of it is you look at the length of the deal and the team, with the possible exception of quarterbacks, the team tends to look at that deal as we're going to maximize that player's value in half of that deal. So if a guy signs a six-year deal, I always look at it as the team thinks they're going to get 3 great years out of him, you know? So if that suspension comes in the first year, then, you know, you're on one of those years already. So it's not so much the cap relief as just, you know, and to get to your point about Le'Veon's injuries, I don't blame the injuries on him, but the nature of that position is you fall off a cliff.
Yeah.
You go from being great to, it's not like you tend to go from being great to good. You tend to go from being like a sport stud back to a guy like D'Angelo Williams, who becomes a backup pretty quick, right? I mean, the Jerome Bettis types are just rare. Guys who not only had a long sustained period of high level play, but also later in their years could adapt to be something else. So, and look, I think the Steelers are going to get something done with Le'Veon Bell, mostly because Art Rooney has said that's their hope. And I think Art Rooney's proven so far, the Steelers president, that when he says something, it's going to happen. You know, he said, hey, we're bringing in Todd Haley and we're going to get better out of Ben Roethlisberger. And that's happened, you know, told Ben and Antonio, we're going to get deals done with you. We're just not going to do them earlier than we want to. That happened. And he said, we want to sign Le'Veon. I think that's going to happen. But if it doesn't, and the Steelers just choose to play this franchise player tag thing out, I don't blame them, because I go back to that suspension history. And, you know, that might be a tough negotiation point for Le'Veon Bell's camp to argue against.
Right, right. And looking at this team, too, I mean, the one thing that interests me is, you spoke to it earlier about the defense. And the one question I had is, it's almost, you mentioned before, they're building a team almost like a Peyton Manning type of situation here, where they're starting to build a team that's more well-rounded to give Ben a better chance, not put it all on Ben's shoulders. Mm-hmm. A big part of that equation is the other side of the ball. Is this defense, yeah, does the defense have a chance to get good enough, fast enough, to, again, take advantage of those 2-3 years left of Ben? Because we saw a lot of good play last year, but it seemed like there's still issues in the pass rush and in the secondary. I know they could draft some guys, and that might, you know, but drafting guys is usually, you know, we had some quick help last year, but drafting guys is usually a process. That's not a one-year process to get those guys to impact. Do you see them playing a bigger part in free agency?
I think they do have a chance to get good enough defensively, because let's face it, some of those guys last year that they were relying on probably earlier than they wanted to, they had all that experience. So that just accelerates their growth, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to be getting maybe your best defensive player back. and Cameron Hayward. Like I said, I think you have defensive line depth now. I'm not sure that's been the case the past few years. Now I think, you know, we've talked so much about their pass rush the past few years, but I think we have overlooked that maybe some of that was just their inability to find guys on the outside that could do it well and keep the defensive front healthy. You saw that when James Harrison got back into the lineup, and I thought Mike Tomlin, for all the criticism he took, mastered James Harrison wonderfully last year. You know, can James Harrison give you 16 great games anymore? No. Can he maybe give you 6 to 8 and then get into the playoffs? Yeah, I think so. He keeps himself, obviously, in sickening shape. So Bud Dupree, we saw emerge as a guy that they hoped Jarvis Jones would be, a playmaker at that position. So, yeah, I think that Steelers secondary that everybody's always concerned about is obviously going to be better with the pass rush. I think the pass rush will continue to get better if these guys develop. You can bring in depth. They have salary cap room right now for true free agency. You can draft depth, or if not draft impact players at that position. But having said all that, let's just say the Steelers next year are a top 10 defense in terms of scoring, right? Which would be a great leap. And let's not forget that, again, in the second half, they rushed, they set the quarterback like we are mostly used to seeing them sack the quarterback in Pittsburgh. All of that might not matter from this regard. Tom Brady is the kryptonite for that 3-4 zone blitz that drives every other quarterback up a wall. And I don't know there's anything the Steelers can do short of implementing a different approach completely against the Patriots, which I'm not sure is possible in this sport, to beat Tom Brady, because he just is the combination ideally built of mind and might to go against that defense. So I think the Steelers are still going to have to either A, get the Patriots at home and get the Patriots a little bit wounded, or B, get somebody else to get the Patriots for them. Because that, as I told Evgeny Malkin in the locker room the day after the AFC title game for the Pittsburgh Penguins, he's a big Steeler fan, the Penguins center is, and he asked me, why doesn't that work? Why can't we beat Patriots? And I said, they are to the Steelers what you are to the Capitals.
Tell them they need him on the line. Yeah, tell them that he can help.
Yeah. But that's it, guys. I mean, it's just a bad matchup. And, I mean, that happens. And sometimes you just have to sort of know that it's going to require a lot more than talent. It's going to require a lot more than scheme. It's probably going to require some luck for the Steelers to get past the Patriots. And I think if you're a Steelers fan, the best hope you have is that the Patriots have played so much football over the past 4 years that, you know, maybe they're due some bad luck in some big key areas.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head with the Steelers need to get, like, the 1 or 2 seed, and hopefully if they had the 2, New England would not have the 1. New England needs to get into, like, a wild card situation, just as you had mentioned earlier.
Yeah.
Much more difficult to win when you have to play that extra game. I mean, they've been playing at home. They've had a bye week, and that's how they basically walk into the AFC Championship. You kind of, as far as the other teams trying to get them, you got to hope, it doesn't look promising at this point, but you got to hope that the Jets or the Bills or, I mean, the Dolphins were at least a playoff team. You got to hope one or more of those teams starts to give them some more competition. That's 6 games within their own division that they, you know, they usually go like 5-1 in their own division, and that makes things a lot easier.
Yeah, you're right. They're following the Bill Cowher model from the 90s, which was have a weak division, own it, and, you know, turn that into a top 2 seed. And the difference is they have Tom Brady and Cowher didn't. But, I mean, and look – that's the way to do it. I mean, the reality is Tom Brady's, even at this point, 17 years in, if he only has to win 2 home games to get to the Super Bowl, there's a pretty good chance he's going to get to the Super Bowl every other year, right?
Yeah, but they don't go 16-1 to get there. Yeah.
The Steelers have lost the games in the regular season to teams outside their division, but the Patriots don't lose. Because the Patriots don't tend to go to Philadelphia and Miami and get their doors blown off. You know, it's one or the other, maybe, not both. So, and that gets back to Ben needing to be better on the road. the Steelers needed to be better against worse. I don't think the Steelers struggle against good teams anymore, with the exception of the Patriots. But they went into Kansas City and beat a pretty good football team and a defensive struggle, right?
Well, twice.
The problem is, yeah. The problem is the Steelers don't win on the road against teams they should handle. It wasn't just last year. It was the Jets many years ago, Cleveland the one year. I mean,
you've got to beat those teams,
and that's the difference.
What's going on there with that? I mean, you know, it seems like, you know, that's something we've said a number of years now, and yet it hasn't changed. What's going on there, do you think?
Guys, I like to think I'm pretty smart, but if I had that answer, I'd be making $6 million a year to coach them. Ben hasn't played well on the road. I think they have gone in at times, and I don't want to say they haven't prepared properly, but I'm not sure their mindset's been in the right place. I think at times when this Steeler offense does what it does over a stretch of home games, it's the worst thing for them. I mean, we can look at every statistic in the world, and I am not a guy who hates advanced metrics. I love advanced metrics. Doesn't mean I understand them, but I love that we can look at these things and measure. But here's what I know. I've been in enough locker rooms over the years to know there is a human element. And when you have 2 weeks in a row in that sport where you blow the doors off somebody at home, right? And the Steelers have had those moments in the past 3 years where they get two teams to come into Heinz Field and it's like Ben throwing for 500 yards and five touchdowns and they're just blowing teams away. All of a sudden, then they go on the road, and what you realize right away is it's hard to do that on the road. And if you're used to that, if things are a little easy, if teams don't put up as much of a fight once you've rung up 30 points in the first half on them, and you're, you know, you take a little bit of a mental holiday. You start.
But this isn't new, though. That's what throws me. This isn't new. I can understand if this is a young team or even a veteran team, but it's the first time they've had great success, and now it got to their heads a little bit. But this has happened year over year over year. They get the sense of urgency now, and yet it still continues to happen.
Well, I think it's some of it's the sense of urgency, but I think some of it is just there is that inevitable moment when you get into another team's stadium where if you don't take the opportunity to jump on them early, it's going to be a fight. And if you look at those games this year in Philadelphia, Steelers had to settle for that field goal opportunity. I mean, they drove right down the field against the Eagles. They go up 7-0 there, you're going, okay, they're going to just continue this. Doesn't happen, right? Same in Baltimore. Good drive, doesn't end up in 7. I mean, you have these moments where the Steelers haven't capitalized early, and I think if you really want to break it down, you look back, it's not that you look at those games, oh, I mean, the Miami game was different. I think the Steelers got pushed around in that Miami game. But in those other games, there were moments early against the Jets that happened that one year. The Steelers could have sort of put their throat on it, that team early, and didn't. And people can blame the defense all they want, but that's the offense, and that's where maybe the offense has to be a little more willing to simplify, to not outthink itself, to just do what's necessary to get into the end zone. That's where I think the Patriots are brilliant. And Brady is brilliant. Brady will take what you give him. He's willing to beat you anyway. He doesn't care if it's Antonio Brown getting the ball or Le'Veon Bell getting the ball. He's Ben Roethlisberger. However, we need to get into that end zone, right? Sometimes I think that's what the Steelers should learn from the Patriots. That's what Ben Roethlisberger can learn from Tom Brady. Take whatever that defense is giving me.
Yeah, he's the king of patience, and I think that's what, you know, I always look third and ones when we go deep. Those are all great when they work, but most of the time they don't. And I feel like Tom Brady's patience is the biggest virtue in his game.
Yep. It's the opposite of what Sidney Crosby did to become the best player in the world again. If you want to look at the analogy just from a Pittsburgh sports perspective, when it was going badly for Sidney, you know, a year and a half ago, he was trying to revert back to his worst tendencies as a great player, which is as a playmaker. He was trying to be too patient. He was trying to get other guys involved. When Sidney Crosby is just like, look, I'm going to create my own offense, and through that, then I'm going to have these opportunities to set other guys up. But when I'm trying to score goals, when I'm going to the net, when I'm playing assertive like that, nobody's better than me. Well, that's how he got back to being the best player in the world. And coincidentally, that's how the Penguins got back to winning a championship. I think with Ben Roethlisberger, it's the opposite. Like you said, third and one, and you go deep and it works, it's great. You know what? There's a reason there are percentages, and there's a reason New England Patriots tend to play them. And there's a reason the New England Patriots have five of these things under Belichick and Brady, and Ben only has two under different coaches.
I think we all agree, and that's what's interesting about this. But tell me a little bit more, I guess. A lot of this is scheme, right? Or a lot of this is impressing upon players the scheme so that they don't audible out of that patient play or other things. We talk a lot about how New England owns this 3-4 defense. He gets the 3-4 defense. He knows how to pick it apart. The death of a thousand cuts, which he'll throw 5-yard passes all day if you give it to him, and who's accurate enough that he will make every one. So tell us a little bit about what the reluctance is to change the scheme. There's a lot of talk about that in the New England game, how we did play man and press, and it didn't work early on, so they moved back out into the zone that also didn't work. Tell us a little bit about the scheme and what your thoughts are on, you know, is there a reluctance to change and play different schemes on Tomlin's part? Is it just a matter of he didn't have enough time?
I don't think... You know what? I'll say this. I think because New England has capable running backs right now, because Bill Belichick has started to get back to the idea that you want a running game. There's about a four or five-year stretch there after they won the third Super Bowl, where I think Belichick, the greatest coach of all time, people tell you, fell in love with the passing game, the short passing game. And they didn't really establish run consistency in New England. And you saw against teams like the Giants how that hurt, right? Because not only couldn't they run the ball, they didn't really stay committed to the run, and Brady was getting the snot kicked out of him, right? But now, granted, without having to blitz a whole lot. But because you have a LeGarrette Blount back there, because they've had this sort of running back emerge every year in New England that sort of, if not comes from out of nowhere, comes off the scrap heap to emerge as either a primary or secondary threat, I think that gives the Steelers real problems. Because what happens is when the Steelers are playing well defensively, they're shutting down the run, and most teams then are forced into passing situations, and that's where the Steelers can sort of use those exotic blitz schemes and cuts. So everybody wants to simplify this and say, why don't they play man coverage and press? Because when they've done that, they've had more success against Brady. And I'll say, yeah, they have, but they also had veteran guys doing that. They didn't really have two veteran guys that they counted on in this game in New England. And I think Mike Tomlin and Keith Butler got into a position where they did what Tomlin says he never wants to do, which is, you know, live in his fears. I think they were fearful of playing press coverage and having those guys run right by sort of a more inexperienced secondary. And with your safeties, because of the way Mike Mitchell plays, a very aggressive secondary. I think that is where the Steelers probably would have been better at that point making an in-game adjustment. I think they went in there thinking we have to play this traditional 3-4 zone. And honestly, we have to hope that we can get there. You know, we can get to him, if not bring him down, get to him. I think their plan was to not have him on the field a whole lot. But when Le'Veon Bell went down, that went out the window. So I don't think it's an exclusive thing there. Those games the Steelers have won against the Patriots, if you look back, they had the ball more. They possessed the ball more. They played efficiently on offense. And Brady didn't have a maximum number of possessions to do his damage with. I just think, though, when you look at this scheme, it's a 3-4 zone blitz against a quarterback who, for whatever reason, can figure out where that opening is going to be before any other quarterback. And as I've said to Steelers fans, they hate hearing this, but if it ends up being historically that the Steelers built the second best team for the entire stretch of Tom Brady's career for the most part, but Brady was just better than them, you know what? Maybe that's just the way the Oakland Raiders and Dallas Cowboys feel about the 70s too.
Yeah, it's definitely a bitter pill to even think about having to swallow, which is, you know, topping down our throats as it is. So, yeah.
Yeah. But it's not like the Steelers have never won. I mean, they've won two Super Bowls. They've been to three. I know it's been a while, but You know, I still think the Steelers, again, to go back to a point I made earlier, gentlemen, I still think if you look at their 2016 season, you would have to look back as a realist and say that they took a lot of steps. The idea is to win a championship again, right? And it's hard to argue they're not building to that. They went back to the playoffs 3 years ago, lost a home game. You know, two years ago, they went on the road against a division rival, won, and played the Super Bowl champs, the eventual Super Bowl champs, tougher than anybody else. I mean, they were the team that had them down at one point, right? And then this year, they won two playoff games, and lost at New England. Now, they got their doors blown off. But you know what? So did the Atlanta Falcons. They just happened to have the Patriots not playing particularly efficient football in the first half, and the Patriots had to come back. But the Patriots did offensively to the Falcons everything they did to the Steelers. It was just, you know, a little bit different look to that game. So, you know, you go back to the playoffs, you win a playoff game, and two playoff games, you know, I still think you can make an argument that this Steelers team is on the rise, and I would, you know, maybe this is this might be a victim of living in a town where you watch it a lot, but I would still say, yeah, the Patriots are the favorite to win the Super Bowl next year. Biggest threat to the Patriots, probably the Pittsburgh Steelers. And you know what?
In their own health.
Yeah.
Because that's what killed the Steelers, too. Yeah.
Well, absolutely. And that's why, you know, you talk about drafting a quarterback. Maybe you draft a running back. I mean, that to me is a thing where it's like, you know, what if something happens to Le'Veon? Because you want to count on D'Angelo Williams again? I mean, I think if there are some running backs in this draft that fit the Steeler mold, that's a position where guys tend to be able to come in and adapt a little bit quicker, especially if you are confident that Martavis Bryant is going to be back. Let's face it, if he's back and he has his head on right and he hasn't completely lost it over the course of a year, the threat of him just running down the field alone is going to change the way teams can defend the Steelers. If you have another running back who can come in and is maybe a little bit younger than Le'Veon Bell, maybe he's a heavier back. Bell was heavy coming out of college compared to what he is now. I wasn't saying he's out of shape at all. But if you have that guy, hey, maybe that gives you a little bit better of an option. And if the idea is to win the Super Bowl, why not have that guy? That's the guy I'd be looking for in the draft.
Just on the same topic, I think some of these things, and you lightly touched upon them, Rob, some of this is just kind of blown out of proportion, too, because, and I think it's one of those situations where if you tell yourself something enough times, you start to believe it, whether it's true or not. Some of these teams they lost to, say, on the road, there was this whole thing, and I dug into it, and I don't remember all the numbers off the top of my head right now. It was like, I think ESPN or somebody dug in, oh, the Steelers lost to this many. This is their record with teams that are 500. Well, one of those was like, the Cincinnati Bengals were 0-1, and it was like the second game of the season. And it wasn't like the Bengals were a bad team. You know what I mean? It was early in the season. And I think the Steelers definitely had best laid plans. And even when you look at it, you said it properly with the Falcons. And I said this is exactly how the Falcons had to attack and why they should have beat the New England Patriots. Was exactly how they went after them the first half of that game. I would have liked to have seen the Steelers do the same thing, but it's very hard to do when you lose Le'Veon Bell. You didn't even have him. He actually carried five times, tried to come back on the field and carry one more, six total carries. He's a huge part of the offense. He's like a third or better of the offense. The other thing with the – let's face it this way. Ben Roethlisberger didn't play in that first game against the Patriots, if not for a phantom holding call at the end. There was a drive in the second half where Landry Jones hit Darius Heyward-Bey for what would have been the second touchdown of that game. The Steelers, and then of course Chris Boswell also misses a field goal following that holding call that brought that play back, and they don't end up getting in the end zone or getting any points. They go into halftime up 17-14 with Landry Jones as the quarterback against the Patriots. That changes a lot of the game plans, even from the Patriots' standpoint. That was also the game where they didn't have Cam Hayward. Cam Hayward had injured that bicep, and he was gone. So you have these unfortunate things that happen in these games, and this is notwithstanding. They should not have lost a game like to the Eagles or to the Dolphins, but you're going to have those things. It's football. They talk about parity all the time, but when you're looking,
yeah. But here's the thing. And your points are all absolutely correct. But I just keep going back to this. All those points are absolutely true. And I do believe the Steelers are very close to the Patriots level. I just keep going back to this. They had to play an extra playoff game. And if they had beaten the teams they should have beaten this year, and we're talking about the Dolphins and the Eagles, they go into that New England game. They're still going into New England, maybe, right? Because of the Roethlisberger injury and everything you mentioned with Hayward in that game against Pittsburgh, or in Pittsburgh. They're still going into New England, but they've had that week, okay? They've had that week. And we, let's face it, when the Steelers are at home, that game against Kansas City looks a lot different, we've seen, because when they're at home, they can boat race teams, right? You go on the road, it's tougher. What's a tougher football game do? It's a little bit more of a physical football game. And I just keep going back to that. People can talk about the matchup all they want. Here's what I would like to see. Wherever the game's played, I'd like to see the Steelers versus the Patriots when both teams are coming off of byes and then victories. Wherever it's in New England or Pittsburgh, give me that matchup in the AFC title game when one of the teams hasn't had to play for however many weeks in a row because they've had that bye week. And then I think we can judge. Injuries will happen, you're right. But that's where the Steelers have been their own worst enemy over the years, is they've not given themselves the best seeding position to make a real run at this in the last 3 years.
Yeah, and let's not short.
And I agree, yeah.
Yeah, it's not shortchanged to the fact that the Patriots got a head start on that game. They moved the Steelers in Kansas City to primetime a day later. And that was the whole Facebook Live thing with Antonio Brown, where he said those a-hole, Mike Tomlin got caught on video saying those a-holes got a head start.
Yeah, but the Patriots also went 3-1 in the first 4 games without Tom Brady.
Too. Yep, that's very true.
It's not like they didn't have obstacles. I mean,
I think a big part of the
Patriots and stomps all over them. I mean, I think you have to respect what they've done. They've put themselves in position almost every year to win a Super Bowl. That isn't by accident. And it's not by cheating. They look for advantages, but for the most part, they get it. And they've taken advantage of a bad division, you're right, for 2 decades. But you know what? Steelers had the Browns in their division a long time, and before Marvin Lewis, the Bengals were lousy. So,
yeah, I can't disagree.
One thing, too, is because of the way the Steelers' defense is structured, I think to get out of that scheme and to scheme for a completely different game like a New England game takes a lot more effort and a lot more time needed.
Yeah.
Than it does for New England, who seems to scheme every 5 minutes to adjust to a team like Pittsburgh. So,
but they're used to week time. That's part of who they are.
Well, exactly. Pittsburgh needs those 2 weeks because you can't change your entire system in a week and a half. But in 2 weeks,
right? Yeah, you're right. And you guys asked about can they get better quickly? Well, they have increased the level of skill on that defense, right? I mean, you look at what they've done in the secondary with the draft. Now, they have, one cornerback that they happen to think very highly of. He hasn't been able to get out of training camp. But, you look at what Bud Dupree brought. You look at, again, some of those defensive linemen now that all of a sudden that's a position of maybe some depth for the Steelers. And I don't just mean warm bodies, guys that can go in there and play. They may have more depth on the defensive line than they've had at any time since, the mid-2000s going into this season. At some point, too, we can blame the scheme all we want. It comes down to everybody on the Steelers has to play better against New England. Look at the Falcons, right? The Falcons didn't win that game because they didn't play a perfect 60 minutes. And really, that's what New England forces you to do. They force you to be at your highest for 4 quarters. And that's really, a lot of teams can't do that. I think the Steelers can. They can. And if they are, I think they have a real opportunity to be the team that takes down New England. But you have to have, at some point, somebody make a play, right? Whether it's intercepting the ball off Tom Brady when he is off on that one throw and taking it back for 6, or whether it's completing a pass that doesn't give him that extra possession that ends up tying the game. But at some point, somebody has to make a play, and really, that's the difference when you think about it.
Right. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. I mean, New England can get away with playing pretty good and still being the best team. Pittsburgh, against a team like New England, has to play their best to be a good team.
Yeah, that's what I was getting
at, too. New England was pretty great against Pittsburgh, weren't they? Let's be honest about that. Like, they weren't just good against the Steelers. And again, it goes back to lip. So people in Pittsburgh think Belichick and Brady are, you know, sort of saying this in a way that I've never perceived them to be saying. How often after the Steelers have taken it on the chin from the Patriots have we heard Brady say, "We know that's a great football team. We know that's a great organization. They are tough. You know, we had to go out there today and fight for every yard, fight for every point." And Belichick overwhelmingly praises the Steelers. Look, I believe that sometimes what drives people nuts about New England is the very thing that I think people should take a lesson from, and that's this. Belichick and Brady legitimately do respect every opponent. And the opponents like the Steelers or the Broncos over the years, they have so much respect for them that they don't allow anybody in that organization to have an off day when they're going against those teams. And that's leadership that I think people sort of roll their eyes at. But to me, it's a valuable lesson, and maybe that's the approach everybody should take.
I agree. And do you think there's something about, and I know we've got to let you go soon, but do you think there's something to the idea that when part of that coaching philosophy is we're just going to outwill our opponent and outmuscle our opponent, which has been in kind of the Steelers' way to an extent. We're going to out-physical them. We're going to out-muscle them as much as we are going to outplay them in other areas. Do you think that mindset actually lends itself to that a little bit where it's not that you disrespect an opponent, but you're scheming in a way, you're leaving some scheme on the table because what you're saying is we're just going to out-physical them and be just stronger than those guys are, which it's kind of, you know, I don't want to say insulting, but it's a little narrow-minded in the sense of
Yeah, it might be oversimplifying it. Yeah, that's true. And that might be oversimplifying it. I'll say this. Maybe it comes down to this. You know, I've mentioned this a couple times about, you know, losing to the bad teams. But the difference is when you see New England play a bad team, they're not playing sloppy and just getting by for the most part, right? They end up beating those teams pretty handily. And I think it's because their attention to detail every week, from a coaching staff to players and everything, is do I think they have the utmost respect for the Denvers and the Pittsburghs of the world, Indianapolis when Peyton was there? Absolutely. But they also have a very healthy respect for the Cleveland Browns of the world. And I think that's why they tend to handle them, right? Not always. They lose their games. But there's a reason they win 13 games every year. I think the difference between the 13 wins and the 11 wins is not different from the difference between 8 wins and 10 wins. And by that I mean, if your mindset, starting from the first day of training camp, through all the exhibition games, through all 16 games of the regular season, is week is its own Super Bowl, then you do not ever get into a point where one game is measured a little bit differently because, hey, you're emotional and that's what happens, or measured differently from being over-emotional. And I think what the New England Patriots have mastered is one thing the Steelers could, they take the emotion out of football. They really make it a game of mechanics, right? They're emotional on the field when things happen.
Yeah, I think
Joe Belichick is a lot like Chuck Knoll that way. To do your job is not that different between act like you've been there before. I think Mike Tomlin's a really good coach. I don't know if he's a great X's and O's coach, but you know what? I wouldn't, because I'm not an X's and O's guy myself. But here's what I know. There's something to be said about never having a losing season in a league that's built for teams to be pretty much around 500. So he's doing something right. That said, maybe the evolution of Mike Tomlin is to be a guy who gets his teams to be less emotional, because maybe that's the final hurdle for the Steelers, an emotional maturity that we'll see in games. If they go and beat these teams that they're supposed to beat and they look almost mechanical about it, the joylessness of the New England Patriots has proven to be very, very effective, and maybe it's something the Steelers should think about a little bit more.
I'm with you 100% on that. Yeah.
Yep, and just to reiterate something that Rob had said on this maybe about a few minutes ago was the point I was trying to get at. You have to play a solid 60 minutes against the New England Patriots because if you don't, like I said, at home with Landry Jones, they could have had him at half. That was only 30 minutes. They come back out and they kill him with LeGarrette Blount. The Steelers dropping passes, not getting in the end zone, the AFC Championship game. It was still a tight game at halftime, and then that's really when the rails came off of things as they come out second half, turning over the football, etc., etc. So Ron and Rob, thanks for joining me today on the show. Rob, any last words you would like to share? You could replug everything again if you would like.
Yeah, download the app at on whatever you download apps, download it or go to upgruv.com. I'll tweet out my podcast. Like I said, it's not going to be real serious. Hey, I enjoyed this. This was fun. We'll do this again. I really enjoyed it. I apologize. I talk too much. So
no, it's cool.
No, that's why we want you on, Rob. No one wants to hear us. They want to hear you. So
hey, I enjoy it, fellas. Thank you so much.
Yeah, right, thank you too. And Ron, exactly. It was like it's exactly like I told you. I end up becoming like the MC. But this is why it's great to have guys like Rob come on and talk, and yourself too, Ron, because you know what? I don't like to live in the echo chamber of just sometimes I'm running these shows by myself and people are just hearing me. So some very great thoughts there. Rob, best of luck with the new show. Go ahead and check that out wherever you download apps. As he said, that is at Rob Rossi _ Upgruv, and Ron Lippock from the Pittsburgh Sports Daily Bulletin, also the author of Steelers Takeaways. Go ahead and check out that book if you have a chance. It's available anywhere. You could definitely find it on Amazon. I'll be tweeting out that link as well. Until next time, folks, be safe, be good, and I'll catch you later.
We would like to thank you for listening and remind our listeners to follow us on social media and our website, www.steelcityunderground.com.